Wubba lubba dub dub, motherfuckers. What is going on, everyone? It is I, everyone's favorite jack of all trades, with the foul mouth, Commodore Urban. And today I got a good one for you guys. I got a book review. And before I begin with my book review, I just want to give a big shout out to all my friends and all my subscribers, and also to all my new viewers for watching the video. And I say, if you are subscribers, newly subscribed, or OGs, thank you for sticking around and watching this shit. The reason why I do it is for you guys. I know quite a few of you are probably going to be sticking around to watch. I know my friend Glenn, my friend Jerry. I know probably Ben will be out there watching. I know Mr. Ball. I know you'll be out there watching. There's quite a few of you. I can't remember all of you, but I know you guys are out there, so thank you for patriotizing. Anyway, without any further ado, the book that I want to review to you guys is about the lovely RMS Titanic. But here's the thing. If you're a Titaniac, here's the thing. If you supposedly know everything about the Titanic, do you really know the story? Do you really know the true story of the Titanic, especially the origins of the Titanic? I can tell you right now, probably most of us probably don't know fucking shit. And so that's the book I'm reviewing to you guys today is Titanic, Belfast Owned, by Stephen Cameron. This is an amazing book. And here on the back, right here it says, 15th April 1912, a date that shook the Western world, the day the great ship, the Titanic, sank, over 1,500 people drowned, a catastrophe so awful and so unexpected that it continues to fascinate and haunt us today. The 31st of May of 2011 marked the 100th anniversary of the launch of the Titanic. It was a launch witnessed by thousands, all gathered at various vantage points in Belfast, to send off ship number 401 at 13 minutes past noon. In Titanic, Belfast Owned, Stephen Cameron looks at this most famous of ships from a new perspective. He tells of the conception and birth of SS 401, as she was known in the yard. Extensively illustrated and packed with detailed information on her early days, this is the story of bringing a dream to life. So ambitious was this dream that men were to die before ever the ship was launched. But even when she had left Ulster's shores to sail to Southampton on the first leg of her fateful voyage, the Titanic had not finished with the people of Ulster. In a gripping and heart-rending chapter, Stephen Cameron writes of Ulster people who sailed with the mighty ship. For many, it was to be their last journey, as the dream turned to nightmare and the glory turned to pain. This is the story of the Titanic's earliest origins and her home of Belfast, Northern Ireland. This is the story of the people of Ulster. And a lot of people will say, what's the true home of the ship? Here's the thing. The Titanic was owned by a British shipping line, the White Star, which was ultimately owned by American. She was owned by a British shipping company that was also a part of a conglomerate owned by American. But in my eyes, she would be always be Irish, because she was an Irish-built ship. Thousands of Ulster men and women worked on her. Men put her together. There were some women that did some of the work, too. And there was a lot of amazing, never-before-heard details in this book. And I will share a few of them with you, just to give you a little bit of a taste of what you've been missing. So basically, the way that the book is set up, you have the acknowledgments forward by John M.J. Anders, which he's a relative of Thomas Anders. Then you have chapter 1, introduction. Chapter 2, construction of SS 401. Chapter 3, the Thompson graving dock. Chapter 4, a gentle shove. Chapter 5, The Launch of the Titanic. Chapter 6, Ghostly Images. Chapter 7, The Belfast Log. Chapter 8, The First Voyage of the Titanic. Chapter 9, Belfast Remembers. Chapter 10, The Belfast Titanic Memorial. Chapter 11, The Human Connection. Chapter 12, Titanic Buildings. Chapter 13, I Saw the Titanic. Chapter 14, The Reality of the Titanic. And there's also Did You Know? An SS Titanic Chronologically. Notes the Chapters, a Bibliography, and an Index. So I will go ahead and I will read you a couple of things here that you may not know. So, now, here is the thing. As you guys probably remember, during a dinner party in 1907 over cigars and port, Lord William Peary and J. Bruce Ismay were concocting the idea of the Olympic class liners. We all know the story very, very well, but here's the thing. But who transformed their ideas from the simple sketches into the largest ships in the world? And there was an article written in here that proves it. The Right Honorable Alexander M. Carlisle, the man who built the Titanic. And it was an interview that he did with someone in a newspaper. And if you want to see it, Carlisle is right there. Here's the thing. The fact is that Peary controlled Harlan and Wolff, and that the designs of the Olympic and Titanic were his. So Peary, they were his. But it was Alexander Carlisle who carried out the instructions and orders given by his brother-in-law, and who brought Ismay and Peary's vision to life. So people saying that Thomas Andrews was the chief designer. Thomas Andrews helped after Carlisle retired, but the main design of the ships, it was Alexander Carlisle who designed Olympic and Titanic. So that's something that was cleared up, which I didn't know. I never knew that. But here's another one. This is another one that's going to be a major fucking, major mind fuck. Right here, it says, right here, it is generally accepted that a ship's maiden voyage begins when she has been handed over to her owners and sets out on her first voyage with fare-paying passengers. When the Titanic sailed from Belfast, she had on board not only crew members and workmen from Harlan and Wolff, but also one fare-paying first-class passenger. Oh, she was carrying a passenger, a fare-paying passenger. The Belfast newsletter of April 1912 stated that a Mr. Wyckoff Durholf, age 61, booked a first-class passage from Belfast to New York. When the Titanic sank, he was among those saved. Mr. Durholf appears to be the only passenger whose passage began in Belfast. It has always been thought that the Titanic sank on a maiden voyage, which began in Southampton, but she traveled from Belfast to Southampton with at least one fare-paying passenger. And this means that her maiden voyage began not in Southampton, but in Belfast on the 2nd of April of 1912. There's your mindfuck. And this entire book, like I said, I'll flip through it. See, this entire book is just loaded with amazing information about the ship's origins and where she was born, Belfast, Ulster. Belfast, Northern Ireland, Harlan and Wolff. So, I give the book 5 out of 5. 2 fucking thumbs up. It is a beautiful book. It will fill in so many fucking gaps in what you know about the Titanic, because honestly, her origins and the Titanic's home, that portion of her story has never really been told. It's been neglected. But Mr. Stephen Cameron has fucking done it right in this book. Get this book, read this book, fill in those blanks in the Titanic story in your head, and understand the Titanic right here as Una Riley, right here at the very last part of the book, right here, it says right here, Una Riley, co-founder and current chair of the Belfast Titanic Society, summed it up perfectly when she said, "What happened was a disaster. The Titanic was not." So there you have it, guys. That is my review of Titanic, Belfast Own, by Stephen Cameron. If you can, pick up a copy of this book, fucking read it, you'll enjoy it, you'll learn something, guaranteed, because I did. And trust me, it was awesome. So thank you for watching, until next time, this is Commodore Urban, saying smooth seas and clear skies, happy sailing with all of you, and God bless. Stay healthy, and stay awesome. Cheers. Peace out.